The main point I want to get across is that this expansion that began after the collapse in March is really starting to mature and gain steam. We may have a temporary setback with COVID lockdowns, but it's not going to derail the recovery. And I think we're transitioning from the initial phase where there's really a strong acceleration coming out. So a lot of the growth indices like the manufacturing PMI, a lot of the risk areas are have really done well. But what I'm starting to see, which you typically see after the initial thrust off the bottom, is a real broadening now, both economically and also financially in terms of more markets participating. And I'll show what I mean by that. And I think more than that, I think we may be at a secular turning point. And I'll show you what I mean by that. So in this chart, what we're looking at is several things. We're looking at the NASDAQ 100 versus the Russell 2000 small cap. So think of large cap tech versus small cap stocks in general. And in blue is the large cap Russell growth index relative to the Russell 1000 value index. And then to get real specific in terms of what really makes the trend of these, it's really boils down to kind of with growth and value, it's really tech versus financials and a few other select sectors. But you can see what we've witnessed over the last several years is somewhat reminiscent of the final years of the late 1990s, in which growth exploded, tech exploded, while other areas lagged well behind technology. And once the peak was in, just like the rise was sharp, so was the decline. And if you look on the far right of this chart, we are seeing a pretty big decline in the NASDAQ 100 relative to small cap stocks. We're also seeing that with growth versus value and tech versus financials. So I think we could be on the cusp of a major secular shift in some of the trends. If you look at these trends, they've really been in place since, I would say, 2006. Since 2006 through 2020, we've seen tech over small cap, growth over value, tech over financials in general. And that trend has been in place for a long time, and we may be at a turning point where that now changes. And part of what kind of goes along with those trends are a couple of other things. The dollar is a key one. So if you look at the dollar, just as tech was peaking in 2000, 2001, that also was when the dollar had peaked. And as I mentioned, that tech bottomed around 2006 all the way through 2020. More or less, you can see in green is the dollar index, which has been rising for most of that time period. And in addition to those trends of the dollar, that's also impacted stocks versus commodities, which is shown in red. And then not only that, but also US stocks versus foreign stocks. So in black, we're looking at the S&P 500 relative to the MSCI World Index, which excludes the US. And so we've seen the dollar, it does look like the dollar has put in a meaningful top. While we've seen so far really big sell-offs in tech versus financials or tech versus small cap, we haven't yet in terms of the S&P versus commodities or the S&P versus world equities, but I think that will be coming soon. And I believe a lot of that will be, which I highlighted last week, is I think we're gonna see a major breakout in Chinese equities, which will fuel a breakout in emerging market equities. Another thing that we're kind of seeing is gold has been a little bit weak here recently. And this was very similar to what happened in 2009. Gold bottomed in early 2008 and had a strong rally into 2009, but then it went sideways for about 6 months or so. And the reason for that, as you can see here, we're looking at correlation. And one of the two determinants of gold are its trend relative to the dollar, as well as real interest rates. And so what happened in mid-2009 was real interest rates started to move up as the economic recovery began, while inflation was still muted because of spare capacity. But once inflation finally started to catch up in late 2009, then gold took off. And you can see on the right, we've got about an 89% correlation to real interest rates, which is the bottom panel. well, around roughly 83% correlation, negative correlation to the dollar, which is in the middle panel. So both of them are strongly correlated with gold, but gold is primarily right now being driven by real interest rates. And so with inflation muted and real interest rates starting to move up, that is weighing on gold. But as I mentioned, I think as inflation bottoms and begins to pick up, that should push real interest rates lower again, fueling the rally in gold. That was one of the things highlighted by the Economic Cycle Research Institute. They have their future inflation gauge, which they call FIG, and has a pretty good track record of calling peaks and troughs in inflation. And they're arguing that inflation will continue to rise well into the end of this year. And this is a delayed chart because this is free to the public, but their updated chart is only posted to subscribers. But they did mention that their inflation gauge continues to rise and argues that we'll probably see a significant bottom in CPI, which will be heading higher in the coming year. Now, what I think 2021 will look like, I think will be a transition year, very similar to 2010 as well as 2017. So 2008, going into 2009, we came out of a recession and we saw a huge surge in the manufacturing PMI up into the high 50s. And going into 2010, it remained at a high level. And during that period, there was a little bit of a transition. We had a sell-off in 2010, but overall the equity markets were strong and put in strong gains in 2010. Similarly, we had a global downturn that ended in early 2016, and we saw the manufacturing PMI jump again to the high 50s, and it remained in the high 50s for a period of 1 to 2 years. And in 2017, we had a very robust equity market rally. And I believe that's what we're going to be seeing. I think we've seen the initial thrust into the high 50s in manufacturing PMI. I think we will continue to operate at a high manufacturing PMI as we continue to see an inventory cycle in which manufacturing is going to replenish what we've seen in terms of the drawdown over the last year. And that, I believe, will lead to a strong equity market in 2021. What I'm also seeing and is encouraged by is market breadth is improving. In black, we're looking at the S&P 1500. So this is small, medium, and large cap stocks. And in red, I'm looking at the percent of those stocks that are in long-term trend, bullish trends, which I measure by a rising 200-day moving average. So you can see recently we hit a new high off the lows where we're north of 45%, moving on 50%. In terms of stocks with long-term bullish moving averages. And so this is why I think we're seeing good, healthy signs in the market and why for clients, right now we're relatively neutral, but on market dips or attractive opportunities, we're gonna continue to push our accounts more towards that maximum risk position in alignment with what our market risk models are arguing for. Another bullish factor is we're hitting a new high in the Fed's balance sheet. The Fed had a huge surge in their balance sheet in April and May that peaked at around a little over $7 trillion. We had a little bit of a sell-off as emergency facilities were run down going from June through July, but we've had a steady increase ever since July. And we're now hitting a new record in the Fed's balance sheet at over $7.2 trillion. And this will continue to grow as we go into 21. So with liquidity abundant, manufacturing remaining strong, to me, this is a very strong period for risk assets going into 21. And I do think 21 will be a strong year in the markets. And those are the main points I wanted to highlight and why I want to take client accounts to maximum risk posture over the coming weeks and months.
That concludes this week's Financial Sense Investment Summary. If you have any questions about any of the topics discussed, or about any of our personalized investment services, feel free to give us a call at 888-486-3939 or email us at grow@financialsense.com. Also, listen to our podcast, Financial Sense News Hour. It's on iTunes, Spotify, or on our website at financialsense.com.